Last time we did a bunch of manipulation for this J2 model, and at the end of the day we landed at this very elegant expression for the elastoplastic tangent operator, right, where we said, okay, it's composed of the elastic, classic elastic tangent, and then there's a correction term that takes care of the plasticity. That term appears only if there is plasticity. If there isn't, it just goes back to the elastic case, right? So make sure that you get that. Make sure that your code is ready to implement that as well, because in the case of an elastic step, the elastic tangent is the one that applies. And I think the only other comment there to confer to is to go back to, right, the 1D case, where you have something very similar, right, where you had the tangent operator, right, being the elastic tangent if there's elasticity, and if not, being the more complex expression which modifies the elastic tangent, as you recall, right? So very similar concept as in 1D. The only other thing to note here as well is that this is the continuum tangent. Later we'll see that there's another tangent called the consistent tangent, which is the one that comes from the algorithm. So far, all we've talked about is the analytical model. We haven't said a word about numerical implementation, right? So, for instance, one thing that I can tell you that could complicate things is that this n hat, remember, is S over the norm of S. And, well, that's kind of what you're looking for. So there is this problem that your tangent now depends on the state of stress. And the state of stress is precisely what you're looking for, right? So it's not as in the elastic case where everything is constant and nice. Okay. So questions so far up to this point? How are you feeling? Yes, sir.
Quick question. So yeah. I buy that there is no plasticity from purely volumetric additional strain states.
Right.
But if, I guess my intuition just feels that at some point that has to break down physically.
Oh, yeah.
And so I'm just kind of curious, like, where is the J2 model then applicable, and where does it start to break down where that isotropic expansion does not actually hold it?
Right. So there are models that are called the CAP models that will essentially establish limits for hydrostatic pressure, right? So you're right. I mean, you can't just put, you know, an indefinite amount of pressure in a material and not expect it to break at some point. So the J2 model, in that sense, has that limitation. So that questions the physical limitations of the model. And then for that, people patch those with, like I said, usually the CAP models will have some sort of a threshold at the hydrostatic axis that says, okay, past a certain point, you have to yield, right? That makes sense, right? But yeah, this model in its current state doesn't account for this issue. Now, there are many other limitations of the model, right? So far, the model is perfectly plastic, right? So your strength, if you will, your radius, the cylinder cannot expand or contract. So it's got many limitations. So that's the other thing that you need to sort of come to terms with, is that, so I think someone said it, all models are wrong, some models are useful, right? So that all of these models will have some physical limitation of some sort. You know, it's up to the modeler to sort of define whether you can live with that or not. And it will depend on your application. If you have an application where your pressures are not expected to be huge, then you don't care about this thing, about not having a pressure limit, right? But if you are dealing with explosives, you know, and then, you know, very high pressures, then, you know, you probably want to look into that, right? So it depends on what you're doing. Yeah, always keep in mind that there is something wrong with these models, always. Anything else? Okay, so I want to integrate this model now, and but before we do that, just the last thing to say is that in the 1D case, if you recall, in perfect plasticity, that is, so let me try to make this as horizontal as I possibly can, there is your sigma y naught, right? And if you go from one state of stress to another state of stress in perfect plasticity, essentially you can go an increment in strain without changing the value of stress at all. They're the same. So same state of stress. Or you can say that the stress is constant. So many times people say, oh, that's perfect plasticity. So they associate the concept of perfect plasticity to the stress being constant. In multi-D, so this is in 1D, in this particular case that we have, where you have your cylinder here on the hydrostatic axis, and here is sigma 1, sigma 2, we're drawing it more like sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma 3, sigma 9, okay? Just to be consistent. You can see that you can start at a point on the surface of the cylinder and then go to another point also on the surface of the cylinder. It's still perfect plasticity, and none of your stresses is constant. Sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma 3 are very likely different between these two points. At least one of them will be totally different. Okay? So the whole idea of constant stresses as the definition for perfect plasticity breaks down as you go from sigma 1, or from 1D to 3D. So these are two different states of stress. What they do have in common is that the magnitude of S1 is identical to the magnitude of S2. That we can guarantee, right? Because we know that they will be equal to kappa. Just like here, you can guarantee that sigma 1 equals sigma 2 equals sigma y naught. So the way to generalize perfect plasticity is not attach it to the state of stress, is to attach it to the plastic internal variable. Okay, so here's your PIV. Here's your PIV. Perfect plasticity means constant PIV. It doesn't mean constant stress, okay? And that constant PIV will impose certain constraints on your state of stress. Like here, it means sigma 1 equals sigma 2. Here, it means that the L2 norm of my deviatoric stress, no matter where I am on the tube or on the pipe, is simple, okay? So just keep that in mind, because again, as you're absorbing concepts, it's very important to have those little differences very clear. Okay. All right. So let's talk about what is probably the most famous or well-known integration algorithm in plasticity. It's definitely the first of its kind, and that's called the radial return algorithm. And it was proposed by Wilkins in 1964. OK, Okay, so it's much later than J2. J2 is a very old model. But Wilkins implemented it. Of course, you can see the date roughly coincides with the advent of computers. Finer differences, finer elements being born, and the need of saying, okay, these are great models, but how do we use them within the framework of computational mechanics? This was the time when structural engineering in particular was starting to look at finite elements, and people were starting to think of plastic responses and how to integrate those. Okay, so what you do in all of these integrators is you take the same ingredients that you had before and you integrate them numerically. So the ingredients never change. So you have additive decomposition of a strain rate. Well, this translates into incremental decomposition of the strain rates. Right? Nothing has changed. So what we're doing here is, if you look at a timeline, we're going to be looking at a discretization of time in the classic way. So, and we're going to imagine that we are sitting at a station Tn where everything is known. What the heck? Okay? And we are given the strain increment that takes us from Tn to Tn plus 1. And we want to solve our plasticity problem. Remember that the plasticity complete problem is essentially finding lambda dot, if you will, at a time station n plus 1. So our nomenclature, when we put subscripts on something, will be, you know, that we're evaluating at that time station. So if we say lambda sub n plus 1, that means evaluated at t n plus 1. Okay. So these deltas, all they mean is delta whatever, you know, delta square, equals that square at n plus 1 minus the same quantity at n. Okay? That's what these deltas would mean. It's pretty standard notation, right? Everybody has seen this kind of notation. Okay. So far, no approximation. This is a, you know, we're integrating, if you will, everything, you know, from Tn to Tn plus 1, and that's what we get, right? There's no approximation right now. Okay. Second ingredient, Hooke's law. All right, so again, this is constant. So no approximation. That means delta sigma equals CE double contracted with delta epsilon E. So I'm just, again, integrating in time. Here's where the fun begins. Then we use the first part. And we say CE double contracted with delta epsilon minus delta epsilon P. Just like we did in the rate form, we can do it in the incremental form. And we can open up this delta, right? And we know that this is sigma n plus 1 minus sigma n equals CE double contracted with delta epsilon, I'm starting to expand this, minus CE double contracted with delta epsilon P. We start from the assumption that everything is known at Tn, right? We have solved the problem at Tn. We are wanting to solve the problem at Tn plus 1. So I can send C sigma n to the right-hand side as a known quantity, I know CE, I know the elasticity, I am given the strain increment, the total strain increment. The only thing I need in order to solve my state of stress is this, right? This is known. All right. It's so known that we actually give it a name. And we call this the sigma n plus 1 trial. Why do we call it trial? Because we take the previous state of stress and we assume that the total strain increment will be an elastic strain increment. And therefore we multiply it with the elastic tangent. And this will give me a state of stress that will be the true state of stress even when there is no plasticity. Right? If there were no plasticity, delta epsilon will be equal to delta epsilon e, and the problem will be solved. Okay, so this is a very classic expression in plasticity. You will see it all the time. So you see sigma n plus 1 is equal to the sigma n plus 1 trial minus CE double contracted with delta epsilon p. And then because this guy had a name, people had to give this guy a name. This is called a corrector. This is called a trial. So these kind of algorithms are called the trial corrector algorithms. Classic structure. Okay, where you try something and you see if it works, and if it doesn't, you correct. Okay. So, okay, if you want to be more specific, this is the elastic trial. This is the plastic corrector. Yeah. Only applies if there is plasticity. If lambda dot is not zero. Right? Otherwise, the trial will be it. Okay, since you need to solve for the corrector, you're gonna need the third ingredient, right? Which is the flow rule. Which in this particular model is lambda dot n hat. So here you need something more sophisticated than what we have been doing before. You're going to need backward Euler. You cannot just integrate this guy. The left-hand side is trivial, it's delta F. So if you take this and you integrate from Tn to Tn plus 1, and this guy, Tn, Tn plus 1, okay, then you multiply times dt, right? So on the left-hand side, you're just going to get delta epsilon p, right? On the right-hand side, you don't know how to integrate this. You need an approximation. That's where backward Euler comes in. So the right-hand side will be approximated using the backward Euler scheme, which says that we are going to freeze this thing. Well, delta lambda will come along for the right, and n hat will be evaluated at n plus 1. Okay, that's the backward Euler first one. Now, if we had done the forward order approximation, this would be delta lambda times n hat at n. Okay? Many algorithms do that. Okay, those are the explicit algorithms. They freeze things at the previous step. They evaluate there, and therefore this increment is pretty true. Now with the backward order, this is implicit. Okay, and it complicates things because again, this n hat is problematic. It's evaluated at the future with a state of stress that we don't know about. So let me just make it. So this guy is equal to S at n plus 1 over the L2 norm of S at n plus 1. So this is problematic. It's one of the sources of our nonlinearity. Okay, this is by definition a nonlinear problem. You're looking for a solution, and your solution is part of your problem. Okay, delta n is simple. It's just lambda at n plus 1 minus lambda at n. But we know lambda at n. Okay, so we essentially, when we find delta lambda, we would have found lambda at n plus 1, or vice versa. You okay? You still with me? Yeah? So far so good? So delta epsilon p, so my increment in plastic strain is according to backward order delta lambda n hat at n plus 1. So I'm going to replace that over here, right? So I get sigma at n plus 1, which is what I'm looking for, is sigma at n plus 1 trial, which I can easily evaluate, minus CE double contracted with this newfound quantity, delta lambda n hat at n plus 1. And then I can expand this corrector, right? Because I remember that I know what CE double contracted with n hat is, right? So what was it, 2 mu? Something trivial right there, right? 2 mu, right? So from this, so let's just say, 2 mu n hat at n plus 1, we know that. Well, and to be more, even more exact, this would be 2 mu delta lambda, because there's a delta lambda. So this will become sigma at n plus 1 equals sigma at n plus 1 trial, which is all known, minus 2 mu delta lambda n hat at n plus 1. Okay, so I continue with this trial corrector form, right? So everything here is known, it can be evaluated. 2 mu is a constant. My problems continue to be that I don't know delta lambda and I don't know this n hat because this guy, these two guys are a function of each other. Now, the other thing that I can note from here is that this corrector has a very particular structure. What can you tell me about that corrector? In terms of a second order tensor, what are some of its properties?
Symmetric and traceless.
It's symmetric and traceless. Very good. So it's symmetric. N hat equals N hat trial. And the trace over n hat is 0, which means that this guy is eutectic. So that means that the corrector, the correction part, only applies to the deviatoric part of a trial stress. So the trial stress always gets the volumetric part right. And then you would get the deviatoric part corrected according to whatever amount of plasticity you have. You see that? Furthermore, if I take the L2 norm of this, if I get the deviatoric, so if I apply the deviatoric projection to this whole thing, remember PD, so you double contract PD with this whole thing. So what do you get from S and plus one if you hit it with the deviatoric projection? Take a wild guess. What's that? SN plus one. Very good. Equals SN plus one trial. Right? Minus 2 mu delta lambda. If I hit PD with N hat N plus 1, what do you think I get? Same thing, N hat N plus 1. Okay. Then I open this guy up. Recall this guy is S N plus 1 over its norm. And then I rearrange terms and put everything I don't know on the left-hand side and everything I do know on the right-hand side, right? So I get 1 plus 2 mu delta lambda over the norm of Sn plus 1. All of that times Sn plus 1 has to be equal to Sn plus 1 trial. Correct. Now, what does that tell you about Sn plus 1 and Sn plus 1 trial? What can you deduce from that expression? That equation gives us a relationship between those two tenses, but you can extract something more powerful than that, more meaningful.
They are coaxial. They are coaxial.
Yeah, they're parallel, they're coaxial. There's only a scalar in front of Sn plus 1. And this guy, call it whatever you want to call it. Alpha, right? You're just saying alpha of Sn plus 1 equals Sn plus 1 trial. So therefore, Sn plus 1 is parallel or coaxial to Sn plus 1 trial.
What does that mean geometrically or graphically? For two tensors.
If you vectorize them, so the only way to see it, for me at least, is to vectorize them in principal stress directions.
Okay.
And then if you vectorize them, they'll be perfectly parallel to each other, right? They point in the same direction. This one is scaled, right? Now, but that leads us to look at this. So then what is the consequence of this here? You don't only try, you absolutely can, because they're exactly the same. They point in the same direction. This guy is a unit tensor, right? So he doesn't care about length, which is the only difference between these two guys.
The alphas get canceled, basically.
Right, the alphas will cancel, right? So you can write n hat and n plus 1 as the original one, which is absolutely identical to the same thing, but with the trial. And the difference from a computational point of view is huge. One is known, the other one is not. So that's a huge result in computational plasticity. This guy Wilkins was a very smart guy. So you then say, okay, I can write my n hat at n plus 1 as the trial, or as a function of the trial s. So you're starting to see a pattern. So what you do is you say, okay, as I enter my algorithm, I'm going to evaluate my trial stress. I'm going to take the deviatoric part of that. So I'm going to compute s at n plus 1 trial. From that, I can get n hat, right? And if I know that, then I get an expression for sigma at n plus 1 equals sigma at n plus 1 trial minus 2 mu delta lambda n hat at n plus 1. And now this guy is known, given our recent development. So my only problem now is delta lambda. It's the only piece I don't quite know yet. But in this particular algorithm, you don't quite have to go through that. You can just observe that it yields. So we're going to apply the consistency condition. F at n plus 1, which is F evaluated at sigma n plus 1, kappa is constant, remember, has to equal, this is S at n plus 1, minus kappa equal to 0. Right? Yes, no? Maybe? And then you further exploit this n hat business, maybe too much, and you say, okay, Sn plus 1 is equal to its norm times a unit vector right in its same direction. So this is just, but you can put this guy together with the trial. This guy is a trial essentially. Right? And you just discovered that that's kappa. So that's your way out. So this guy is just kappa and hat. It's all known. So it's being known to you. Okay. So this is really it. So this is what the algorithm looks like in stress space. This is what it's doing. Again, I love these geometrical interpretations because I think they're so enlightening. So if this is your hydrostatic axis, this is your cylinder kappa. Let's say you're sitting somewhere here. This is, call it sigma n. You can be either inside or right on the cylinder. It doesn't matter. You take a jump. This is what we are going to call sigma n plus 1 trial. And then what the algorithm does is that it returns you back to the surface. And this will be sigma m plus 1. And that return, you will see, is orthogonal to the cylinder. In fact, it's a radial return. And the way to see it is here on the pipe plane. So, if you look at this thing on the pipeline, this is what you see. It splits as a circle, right? And its radius is kappa. Okay? And here on my sketch, I have sigma n inside of the yaw surface. Here's your trial state. So here's sigma n plus 1 trial. And then your return will bring you exactly here. This is the true sigma n plus 1. Okay, and then you will see that this distance, this length, who could tell me what that distance is? What is that? Well, that's the L2 norm of S1, of S n plus 1 trial, right? This guy. That's really what it is. Maybe it is related to the elasticity, I'm sure it is. This guy here is right. In fact, that's kappa as well. It's kappa. So, in this particular case, you don't need to explicitly compute delta lambda if you don't want to, right? I mean, essentially, you can exit the algorithm without it, right? Because all you do is you correct sigma n plus 1. You see that? But you also can compute the plasticity if you want to, but in this particular case, you see that the solution of delta lambda doesn't seem to be a very big deal. So this is what's called a radial return. Right, so very, very simple algorithm. Of course, this is orthogonal. You So this is orthogonal. And then this has no component. The corrector has no component in the hydrostatic axis. Whatever you had in the hydrostatic axis is the exact thing. Please ask questions.
Can you please explain again why the distance between the origin and sigma n plus 1 trial is the norm of Sn plus 1 trial?
So you don't understand why this is Sn plus 1 trial?
Yeah.
But you do see it here.
Because that's kappa, yeah.
Right. Of a way to explain that. The easiest way I can find of explaining it right now is that every time you're looking at the deviatoric plane, or the pi plane in this case, you are looking at the deviatoric component of the stress. So this perspective always gives you a space which metric is essentially the L2 norm of S. Remember we talked about this decomposition. The point sticking out, the axis sticking out is the hydrostatic axis, and then there is a space which is orthogonal to that, which is the deviatoric space. On that deviatoric space, the L2 norm of S is essentially what you're seeing. A distance on that plane will be the L2 norm of S. So any point you're in, the distance from that point to the origin will always be an L2 norm of S, of a deviatoric component of S, of sigma, right? So.
Basically, you're not moving in the hydrostatic direction, right? You're staying in the same point. And then you have that relation at the bottom that tells you that you are contracting Sn plus 1 trial to get Sn plus 1.
Yeah.
That's a certain percentage of that.
Anything else?
So pretty much the scaling factor over there is alpha or 1 over alpha. The scaling factor between the distance from the origin to sigma n plus 1 and
right.
From the origin to
it sigma. Would be 1 over alpha, right?
Yeah.
Now, if you really wanted to compute that, let's see, can we... Here, well, this is kappa. We would still have to solve for delta lambda.
But that's possible, right? Because Sn plus 1 is known, and that's kappa.
Sn plus 1 is not known. It's magnitude.
This is magnitude.
Yeah, so you know this. This is kappa.
Right.
Right, so you can write 1 plus 2 mu delta lambda over kappa. All of that is Sn plus 1 equals to Sn plus 1 prime, right? That much you know. And then if you divide everything by, say, the magnitude of Sn plus 1 trial, let's see what happens. Then this becomes n hat, right? And
I can multiply everything by n hat. So you have another building.
And then you write this in terms of n hat. So this would be Sn plus 1 times n hat. Then you get rid of n hat.
Mm-hmm.
This is kappa. So you will get something like 1 plus 2 mu delta lambda over kappa multiplying kappa has to be equal to 1. Is that right?
Kappa over the norm of.
Ah, yes, over the norm. Yeah, okay, so this has to be equal to the norm of the simplest one trial, which is no. Right? And then this will be, then you can solve for that lambda. Right, so you know the amount of plasticity. So, in fact, yeah. And I'm trying to, I think from here you can probably calculate this distance.
It's just minus kappa.
Which that is going to be.
That minus kappa.
Hmm?
That minus kappa.
This minus kappa?
Is
no, there's got to be some plasticity in there. Right? So let's see, let's do it. So this would be kappa plus 2 mu delta lambda. Then these kappas will cancel out, right? And this will be this L2 norm of the trial, let's say. Is that right? Mm-hmm. Then kappa equals this minus this. So this distance here is 2 mu. So it's, yeah, your plasticity has to come into the picture to scale things accordingly. And from here you can calculate your plasticity, right? So your plasticity will always be delta lambda equals whatever the difference between the L2 norm is over 2 mu. In fact, people call this guy, guess what they call that? What's the L2 norm of Sn plus 1 trial minus kappa? What does that remind you?
F trial?
It's called F trial. All right? Excellent. Fn plus 1 trial. So that's how the algorithm works. So the first thing you do, and I think this is what the project is going to be about. So you evaluate sigma at n plus 1 trial. And then you try and see if that meets the yielding condition, right? Meaning, is that, does that give me an F that is less than or equal to 0? The answer is probably not. In fact, it will give you something that is greater than 0 because this distance here, as you can see it from this sketch, will be positive. And then you can scale that with the Young's module, with the shear modules, to get delta lambda. Then from that, you can essentially scale back the true strength of sigma n plus 1. So.
So is this where you would step out of the algorithm if you're purely elastic?
Yeah,
you
so
step out before that.
Yeah, so if your F trial is less than or equal to 0, you say, oh, I'm good. Right? I happen to take a step, say like this. That would give me an L2 norm. So this distance here will be less than kappa, right? So my F trial would be negative. And I would say, oh, I'm fine. I don't need to compute it. Or if I just happen to touch the boundary, also this will be 0. Delta lambda will be 0. And I would call that elastic.
Is that the earliest part where you would step out from an elastic, determining between an elastic plastic step, or can you normally do it earlier?
So, what do you mean? I'm sorry, I didn't get that question.
So, if you're doing some trial step,
yeah,
is this the spot? This is the earliest spot where you can step out if you have plasticity or not, or is there?
Oh yeah, this is it.
That's the earliest.
This is it.
Okay.
Yeah, this is it. Before that, you don't know.
You don't know that.
Yeah. So somehow you're going to have to evaluate. Yeah. So the only way to know is to say, and all the algorithms will work like this, even the more complex ones. You will compute some trial state, and you would say, does that work? Right? And the only way to know if that works is to apply the consistency condition, and or F trial, right? And if F trial is happy, then you're happy, you exit. If F trial is not happy, then you go through all the hoops. It's the only way to know. And therefore, if that happens, you need your tangent needs to be CEP and so on, and so all of these things happen. Any other questions? So I'm thinking that the first part of a computational project is essentially going to be coding this with the ability to have some hardening, which is what we will see later on. And we'll build on this to go to something slightly more complex for the final part. It looks innocent, but once you start coding, it's not so innocent. Okay, so I think that we are happy with this. So let's look at some of the features of this algorithm. So now, finally, we're starting to get into the algorithmic parts of plasticity. Oh, another way to see to the question that you asked as to whether we knew that this was essentially a metric of L2 norm is to see it in the rotated axis. This, I think, is sigma 1 double prime, and I think this is like sigma 2 double prime. And you get to see that any circle centered at the origin, right, on this space is essentially, essentially, any radial distance from the origin on that rotated space is a circle. And that circle, so you're going to get something like sigma 1 double prime squared plus sigma 2 double prime squared square rooted. That would be identical to this. So that's how you know that any circle on this plane is a metric,
right,
of an L2 norm.
Right.
Okay. That just came back to my mind. So that's a more mathematical, more rigorous way of saying, okay, that's what I'm measuring. Okay, so return mapping features. So what are some of the salient features of this algorithm? The most important one that will have a lot of consequence to everything you do with this algorithm is that you're using backward order. Okay? This means implicit. Every time. Okay, and I don't know if you remember, but the first place where you use that, where you use backward order, is in the integration of the flow rate. Okay, and 99% of these models, of these integrations, that's what they do. They integrate the flow rule with backward order. And that's where everything sort of gets triggered. Okay, the cheap way of doing integration is to integrate that flow rule with, say, forward order. And then everything becomes very, very simple. But you'll see that there'll be a price to pay when you do that. And that has to do with certain violations of consistency and things like that. But, okay, backward Euler buys you essentially exact satisfaction. So this is, you know, this is f at n plus 1 exactly equal to 0. So backward Euler will always get you that satisfaction. But the price that you will pay is complexity. Right? You will carry this implicitness throughout, and that will complicate your algorithm. In this case, you didn't need to iterate, but there, in most of the cases, you will have to. Okay? The reason why you didn't have to iterate was why? What saved the day?
Test your plastic internal variables constant.
That's one reason, but the main reason is here. You just got lucky that the direction of your plasticity happened to be all-encompassing your trial state. Right? Otherwise, this would have become a nightmare. So this algorithm, you got it easy, but in general, it won't be that easy. So from one, it follows that this is first-order accurate. Yeah, you learned that in some course in computational methods, right? So this is order delta epsilon globally, and you will have order delta epsilon squared, so second order accurate locally as you go from sigma n, say, to sigma n plus 1. But the one that really matters is this one. So you're first order accurate. So that means that your delta epsilons cannot be just wildly large, okay? Because you will pay in terms of accuracy. But okay, from an stability point of view, you're good. Even though you're losing accuracy, your algorithm will always be stable as long as you're implicit. You have unconditional stability. But you need to pay attention to accuracy. It will be exact. This particular algorithm will be exact for what we would call radial loading. Okay? And what that means, radial loading, I have called it an n hat constant. So you take any path along a direction where you're not changing the direction of n hat, and you will be exact. Okay? You start changing the direction of n hat, and you lose this property. So how do you get this? You need to be proportional. Meaning your deviatoric stress is some function of time times some constants, but the same function of time affects all three of them. Okay? So S1, S2, and S3 don't have to be equal to each other, but they do have to be proportional to each other, okay? And you always have to emanate from the hydrostatic axis, meaning that alpha at t equals 0 has to be 0. Okay, so your deviatoric stresses.
Just a quick question. This alpha has nothing to do with the alpha.
No, no,
okay.
No. It's a total abuse of notation.
Okay.
So call it little f if that makes you more comfortable. Yeah. So let me give you a couple of physical examples where you will see this radial loading. And you'll see more geometrically what it means. So that means that under those conditions, you can test your algorithm, and your algorithm will be exact. There'll be no issues whatsoever with accuracy. So let's do a couple of cases. And again, these are classic loadings. This is called axisymmetric. So the classic example, even in the laboratory, is what some people would call the triaxial loading, but I like the term axisymmetric better. It's more correct. So we can call this our sigma 2, this is our sigma 1, and this would be our sigma 3. We're loading this sample with a state of loading, say sigma A, sigma R. So axisymmetric just simply means that there are two axes, or the, you know, around the radial direction of this sample, you're loading with the same amount of stress, sigma R. Okay, and then sigma A can be whatever it wants. So your state of stress looks like this. Sigma A, sigma R, sigma R, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. Okay? You can also see it as a cube, if that makes you feel more comfortable. Okay? The little cylinder makes you uneasy. Okay. Do a little cube. And it's the same thing. Okay? Then pressure becomes, right, P is 1 over 3 sigma A plus 2 sigma R. And you can compute, did I do that? Of course not. You can compute S and find out what it is. Okay, let's see, we have time, so let's try to do it. So S would be sigma minus this guy, essentially, right? In each, for each term. So each of the diagonal terms, because remember there is the direct delta next to P, right? So this guy becomes
two-thirds,
right? Sigma A minus one-third, no, two-thirds also, right? Sigma R, what is this guy? Two-thirds sigma R minus two-thirds sigma A, is that right?
One-third,
good. Just making sure you're paying attention. Two-thirds sigma R minus one-third sigma A. All right, so can we show some of these properties? Let's see. Well, a common factor seems to be sigma A minus sigma R one-third. Let's see. So I can rewrite things as
I don't think that's right. I don't think the trace is zero. It should be one-third sigma R.
Where? 2233
should be one-third sigma R.
Here? Yeah. One-third sigma R? Okay. Good. Is that right? Then we're all happy? That makes more sense, because then we can factor things very easy. Then the common factor is sigma A minus sigma R, okay? And then this just becomes, in this case, two-thirds. In this case, minus one-third. In this case, minus one-third. Yes or no? okay? Everybody else is zero. So, from a mathematical point of view, from what we said earlier, we check in the sense that we are proportional. For sure, everybody, here is your f of t, whatever this is.
Is there a reason as to why we are leaving the one-third inside?
No, we could have taken it out. It doesn't really matter. We can make this over 3, and then this just becomes 2 minus 1 minus 1. Yeah, it doesn't matter. Okay? The point is that inside of a matrix, you have this constant, and outside, you have this function of t, which controls the evolution of s. Furthermore, this requires an f at t equal to 0, so at the beginning of loading, be 0. So that requires sigma a equals sigma r at t equals 0. So that puts you on the hydrostatic axis. In fact, yeah, it puts you on the hydrostatic axis, I was going to say at the origin. Not necessarily at the origin. So if I draw this thing in 3D space, sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma 3, here is my hydrostatic axis pointing out at you. Initially, it puts me there with sigma A equals sigma R. Or in other words, sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma 3 being all equal to each other. Then I have a constraint because I'm in axisymmetric loading that sigma 2 and sigma 3 are always the same. So sigma 2 and sigma 3, here is the sigma 2 equals sigma 3 line on this plane, if you will, sigma 2, sigma 3, right? And then sigma 1 can be whatever it wants. So when I'm looking at it on the deviatoric plane, all I see is an evolution of loading that on this perspective seems to follow the sigma 1 line, but that is because of the perspective and the requirement that sigma 2 equals sigma 3. You see that? So that's a radial loading. Now you can feel more comfortable about it. So, okay, and eventually you're going to hit the L surface. Now let's do a couple of other perspectives. Let's do the perspective where this is sigma 3 double prime. So this is your hydrostatic axis. This is what we've been calling sigma 2 double prime. So this guy would be sigma 1 double prime. This is sigma 2 double prime. Sigma 3 double prime is sticking out at you. So now we're looking at sigma 3 double prime, sigma 2 double prime, and sigma 1 double prime is sticking out. Okay? So here, the requirement is that we start at the hydrostatic axis somewhere. That's this point. Right? And then what else do we know? What else can we say? Is there anything else that we can say? We would need to know I don't have here the other axes. I know that this is sigma 2, or at least similar in perspective. That's the hydrostatic axis. That's about as much as I can draw from that perspective. I cannot tell you if this thing goes like this or if it goes like that. I'm losing perspective.
In any case, you're going to be parallel to the plane, sigma two double prime, sigma one.
Yeah, so then if that's the case, then it's got to go like this.
Mm-hmm.
And that would make sense because here is my, so here is N hand. Okay, and here is N hand. So that's an N hat constant path. So it's got a little bit. So it's as radial as it gets, pretty much. Okay. So it starts at the hydrostatic axis and just goes radial, so orthogonal to the hydrostatic axis.
But shouldn't it move along the sigma 1 axis?
Right, but that's the thing that I don't know in here, where is the sigma 1 axis? I've lost perspective of that. You're right, yeah. So if you look at it in another perspective, I have here another perspective, which is this. So in my notes, I have it like, if you draw it like this, sigma 3, sigma 1, sigma 2, like this. So then, this is a sigma 2 equals sigma 3 line. And then it can be whatever he wants in sigma 1. See what I mean? So, so let's say this is the value. So this is your radial loading. All right, so it's whatever he wants in sigma 1. And then these two guys are constrained to being equal. Right? This guy has to be sigma r, and this guy has to be sigma r. Right? But then I'm lacking clarity as to how that translates over there. It probably doesn't do this. I'm not sure. I don't know. It's
hard to tell.
Huh?
No, I said it's hard to tell.
It's hard to tell. Yeah, I cannot tell. It seems like it might be at an angle. I don't know. But anyway, that's that. Okay. So take this one. Put a big question mark on this one. From this perspective. This one I know it's right. That one I know it's right. This one I'm not sure. Okay. Should we keep going? Another example, another quick example. So the other classic loading is simple shear. So this one we saw two principal stress directions are equal to each other. In simple shear, things are, well, simple. So in simple shear, so that was axisymmetric loading. In simple shear, sometimes people call it two-dimensional loading. You just have one stress tau and another one here tau. And of course, for equilibrium, you need these two. You have a little cube and you're just shearing. Okay? The state of stress for these in principal directions is tau 0 minus tau. everybody else is zero. You can check it. You essentially write, so this is in principle stresses. You can pretty much write zero, tau, zero, tau, zero, 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 zero. And when you take the principal stresses of that, you'll find out that this is it, okay? So that's that. And then you can compute S as we did before. It's even simpler. S is sigma, right? Because this is already traceless. So then everything is tau 1, 0, minus 1. So you're again meeting the condition of proportionality. Right? Everything is proportional to whatever tau is going to be. And then the only further requirement is that tau is zero at time zero. Okay? And then you sketch this. Okay, so I have a couple of sketches here. So sigma 3 is here, sigma 1 is here, sigma 2 is here. By the way, what is sigma 2? In this case?
Zero.
Zero, that's your intermediate stress. Okay, so you're leaving on the plane sigma 1, sigma 3. Right? Sigma 2 is always zero. And you're leaving on an axis where sigma 1 equals the negative of sigma 3. Okay? So that's on this plane, along a 45 degree angle. Right? If this is a plane on the blackboard, right? So you're condemned to taking stress paths along this line. So this is minus tau, that's tau, whatever it is. Then if you look at another perspective, the pipeline, sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma 3. Here's your yield surface. Okay? Again, you're stuck on this plane, right? But this is the minus sigma 3. You're stuck to a line of, this is the line sigma 3 equals sigma 1, or minus sigma 1. So you're stuck to flowing along this line. See that? Now let's compute the L2 norm of this. So the L2 norm of this would be what? Right, so this would be square root of 2 tau, right? So that will have to be equal to kappa at U. Yeah. So if you do a simple shear test and you break or you start flowing at a certain shear tau, you know how to calibrate kappa based on that result. So you know that kappa would be square root of 2 tau, whatever that yield strength is. Okay, so that's how you start calibrating this model. Questions. I think that this lecture, I hope that this lecture convinces you of the importance of geometry and plasticity. Okay, the ability to see things in these different perspectives is what will give, what will make you a good plasticity modeler. For instance, our lack of insight here is a disaster. I mean, we cannot see where we're going. Okay, if we were debugging our code, we wouldn't be able to tell if the if what we're seeing on this perspective makes sense or not. Okay, so we would have to look at it here, and we would it seems like it's okay. Yeah? Then we look at it here, and it seems like it's okay, but if we put it here, we don't know. Okay, and this uncertainty will not let you sleep. Okay? So you need to become very comfortable with all these different perspectives, putting things upside down, saying, okay, does that make sense? Does that meet the conditions that I'm imposing on this model? Is my tau that I'm computing that I show it's a yield? Is it kappa over square root of 2? You know, all of these things have to check. And for that, you need to be able to put the model upside down, split it into different perspectives. Plotting in 3D, I think, is nice for impressing people when you're giving a PowerPoint, but it won't be enough for doing, you know, quantitative things. Very likely you have to print things or plot things on planes. And that's when this plane, this kind of plane, or the other one, the sigma 3 double prime, sigma 2 double prime planes, that's when they become really, really useful. Okay, so start to play with those, because those are your friends in trying to understand what you're computing. Everything else will just be too obscure.